All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Xavier Ducrohet. I'm the tech lead for developer tools for Android at Google.
And my name is Hans Dockter. I'm the founder of Gradle and the CEO of Gradleware.
All right, so we're going to talk about the Android build system. So we wanted to start a little bit by talking about our motivation and really like on the Android side, right? So Android, well, first I want to ask, who is currently using Gradle to build Android applications? Okay, that's a lot of you. Who is using Maven? One, okay. Who is using Eclipse and Ant? Okay, a few of you. All right, so then I guess we'll go through some of those introductions a little bit faster. But it's interesting to look at the motivation that we had when we designed Gradle, when we designed, from our perspective, you know, the new build system based on Gradle. So when you look at Android, it's a little bit, you know, it's a very complex build system. It may not look like it, but we have a lot of languages. You know, you have Java, of course, you have native code, of course, you have AIDL, you have, you know, RenderScript, you have, the resources is not really language, but both AIDL, RenderScript, and our resource mechanism generate code, so that's complicated. And it really makes something relatively complicated when you look at the build process, right? So that's, it's not even up to date. So I'm going to show you a few things here. So at the beginning, you have like merging of a lot of resources and source file coming from different variants. We'll talk about that a little bit. That flow here is RenderScript, either native RenderScript with just regular classes here on bytecode, and like the support mode where we generate non-RenderScript code, native code to run on, you know, older devices. So that's that flow here. Here we have a single flow, a very simple flow going from Java compilation to ProGuard to Dex. But in fact, of course, ProGuard is optional. Then you have instrumentation. Then we have multi-Dex now. And that flow here is like, I don't even know how to represent it on a chart like that. And that's just one version, of course, right? If you look at, you know, a lot of developers are going to want to do a lot of things in their Android application that we never thought about at the beginning. They want to inject new steps in any of those, you know, between any of those squares. They want to do, you know, dependency injection. They want to do a lot of things that really require a developer to do more than just going and hacking some build script somewhere. Or dealing with like your builder in Eclipse is just like a black box and you have no flexibility whatsoever. So being able to enable developers, you, to do any sort of modification that they wanted was a big motivation for us. You know, I explained that, you know, that's like one variant of it, but there's a lot of requirement also that come from Android. The simplest one, when you look at the platform level, is, well, you need a special version to debug versus the version that you ship as a release build. So suddenly you need to build two versions. In the ecosystem part, you have, well, you have, you know, older devices, because not every device runs Lollipop, unfortunately. You have, you know, things like, you know, different densities, different ABI, right, shipping for Intel CPUs or ARM CPUs. And there's a lot of things here where you don't want to just have one APK that contains everything. And then there's, you know, just you all who have told us loudly that, you know, well, I have a version that's slightly different from my other version and I want to be able to manage that more easily than I can right now. Some people have, you know, abused the flavor mechanism that we introduced to generate hundreds of flavors. And I'm like, you know, I don't, you know, it's like, you know, we had to plan for that. It's kind of, to me, it's kind of a little bit like a crazy edge case, but we have to support it and we have to support all of you. And so none of that was possible before with Ant and with Eclipse, and so we had to design something new. And all of that flexibility was very important. So the big thing, though, is that we wanted to make sure that it wasn't, you know, like we had flexibility in Ant before, right? It's like, hey, just go and edit the Ant script and just make it happen yourself. That's not a good solution, right? So we wanted like really a good build system that really felt like, you know, was designed for it and wasn't some, you know, hack, you know. That's kind of like a weird word, but it's like, you know, like when I see some developer who are doing what they're doing in their Ant script, it's like, it's very scary. And then when you do that, of course, you lose completely the integration in Eclipse, so we really wanted to do that. The other part that was really important was the IDE integration, right? I just touched on, you know, like you do a lot of customization in Ant, it doesn't work in Eclipse, and that's a big problem. And being able to do all of those customization in one place and have it work, you know, everywhere was really important. So in when we designed all of that, you know, we created that model that, you know, you all know because you're using Gradle already. So, you know, flavor, build type, etc. You know, we have the API, we have everything, but whatever you do, right, it just works in the IDE. We send that model that we created, that you guys define, right, you know, creating those flavors and things like that, and we just use that, you know, everywhere. And that's really, to us, that was really something really important. You know, because our goal was really to create one true Android IDE, you know, like our current or old IDE integration, the Eclipse plugin didn't really feel like it was a good Android IDE. It felt more like, you know, hey, we are plugging some Android feature into Eclipse, and we wanted something that felt really native. So with that custom model, we can really have Studio understand exactly everything that you defined, the flavor, the variant, and all of that, and it just works, you know, great. Now Studio is very aware of everything that you're doing. So the thing also that's important, you know, all that flexibility is that the API that we provide will give you, you know, Studio doesn't need to know about your custom thing. You know, what matters is that your custom steps, your custom logic, basically modify the model that is sent from Gradle to Studio, and then Studio just understand that new model. So if you have some custom code to generate dynamic, you know, dynamically generate flavors, not a problem, right? What matters to Studio at the end is all the flavor that you generate. That's what matters. So Gradle, we chose Gradle because it offers us the ability to do all of that, right? The tooling API and all of that was really important.
from a Gradle side, IDE integration is has always been a first-class citizen in how we model Gradle, and that's why we have this separate thing called tooling API, because we don't want that the IDEs directly integrate with Gradle. For various reasons. So one is stability across Gradle versions, right? So when using the tooling API, it can interact with Gradle versions of the past and Gradle versions of the future. So when a new Gradle version comes out, you don't need to update your IDE unless you are.
So in the future you won't.
Pushing it like Android Studio and always needing the newest features. But once this consolidates, we see this with many other technologies that are integrated in the IDE. When you directly integrate with the platform, you always need to you have a one-to-one mapping of a certain plugin version in the IDE with a version of the platform. And the tooling API will eventually, once things have consolidated, leads to a very very stable IDE behavior in regard to different versions of Gradle. The other is runtime isolation. We want to take away the burden that the IDE needs to take care of that the Gradle processes run in isolation, at the same time run as fast as they can. There's some high-level services in there. The IDE doesn't need to take care of provisioning of the Gradle distributions, managing the daemon, and we will see much more of that in the future, a very rich interaction with the IDE. So we have that already via the model. That's already more than what I think I wouldn't know any other deep integration between build systems and IDE that is that rich. But what you will see in the future, for example, is that when you execute tests via Android Studio via the tooling API, the tooling API will actually execute the tests, but send rich events to Android Studio so that you have that you have the rich visual representation of the test run. But at the same time, you can do all the customizations you need to set up your test fixtures in the Gradle build script, right? And this will work. You don't have a different behavior when you run your tests in the IDE compared to running them in directly via Gradle. And that's what we saw in many organizations. They say, oh, we want to run our integration tests via the IDE. So they had a build wiki, or first you need to create the test fixture via your AND or your Maven build, and then you can go in the IDE and execute the tests. That kind of is not our vision. So that's, and there's a lot of other rich interaction stuff you will see. Testing will be the first one on the list where this really starts to shine. The other thing is Gradle has been built. It's one of the very strings that you can elegantly and powerfully extend it, right? And the Android plugin is the best example. I mean, it's a full new platform. that is now based on Gradle, but it's an external plugin using mostly the public Gradle API, sometimes the internal ones, but nonetheless, still, it's an external plugin, and that is a very good example how you can extend Gradle. So in Gradle, everything is deeply modeled, right? And that means you can easily query and extend it. So for example, you can ask questions, I want to extend Gradle in a way for every free flavor you have defined, right? Please do an additional check of the dependencies whether they all have a non-commercial license. Or, hey Gradle, give me the repository container. If any repository has been added that is not an allowed repository, let the build fail. Or, if a test task takes longer than X milliseconds, issue a warning in real time. Because there's a rich model in Gradle, it's super easy. That all those things, you can extend Gradle with a few lines of code, right? And that is one of the very strengths. So one consumer of the capabilities are you, basically, as Android developer, writing your custom Gradle build. But even if you say, oh, I don't need to extend anything, those extendability mechanisms are key for a rich plugin ecosystem that you then use. And that is another strength that plugins, because can do a lot of valuable stuff because Gradle is so extendable and it's so straightforward to extend it. So, as part of the new build system, you have now a nice plugin system already based on the Android plugin. So you have the Gradle as the foundation, then you have the Android plugin, and then you have plugins extending the Android plugin, right? So MoneyMo and similar virtual in the cloud devices provider, RoboElectric, performance tracking. There's a lot out there. And then, of course, you can make use of all the plugins that are more general purpose, the Git release plugin, code quality plugins, other languages that are supported, AWS, and there are hundreds and hundreds of plugins out there that have value for Android developers.
Okay. So, by the way, there's like on the floor, like the exhibition floor, there's a bunch of companies who are doing like performance monitoring for your app, and they all have like Gradle plugin. And it's really amazing to me because it's like, you know, that you just apply their plugin and then it just hooks correctly into the right thing. You know, it does bytecode manipulation to add their tracking and then it just works. You have nothing to do and it just, you know, out of the box. And then Studio works too, right? Because, you know, Studio doesn't care about like that extra step. It just works. And whether you build from Studio or whether you build from, you know, Gradle, just works the same way. So let's talk a little bit about, you know, some of the base concepts, which I guess I don't have to talk about it too much because apparently you all know them. Right. So I'll cover some of them. So, the biggest thing that we did, and I think the part that's interesting here is that, you know, we didn't, you know, I didn't work with like hands to define those concepts. We actually, you know, my team, we sat down and we said, okay, we need to create the new build system for Android. Let's figure out some of the concepts that we could create based on feedback from developer like you. And we came up with like build type, product flavors, and variant. And then, you know, we went to Gradle and said, hey, you know, we have this thing, can we actually even do that? And Hans was like, sure you can. And that was 2 years ago, and you know, we shipped actually 2 days ago the RC1 for the plugin, although it's called, you know, 014 something, but it's like kind of like a 1.0 RC1. And about 30 minutes ago, we shipped Studio 1.0 RC1 as well.
Cool, hey.
It's been a long road, but we're getting there. So build types, so they control how your app is built. So that's typically debug versus release. If you want to have like a debug version that accesses a staging server versus your production server, you can create a new one. You can create as many build type as you want. You have a bunch of flags that you can set on it, like, you know, whether it's debuggable, whether you want to run ProGuard and things like that. Signing configuration also is important so that your debug is signed differently from your release one. The other big dimension is product flavor. So product flavor is to create a different version of your application. And that's where you're going to define, you know, maybe you have a game and you have a free and a paid version, right? The free version uses ads, and so you want to create two slightly different versions of the same one. So that's a good way to do that. In the Play Store, we have multi-APK support, so you could do a version specialized for like an older version of Android, like Gingerbread or, you know, whatever version, and then a newer version for ICS, and then another version for Lollipop, you know, depending on what you want to do, right? It might be easier for you if you want to do something like very native to Lollipop, to just create a Lollipop only version. That's up to you, right? You have the flexibility for it. And we used to do version flavor as well for splitting packaging, you know, like one version for ARM, one version for Intel. And I struggled through here because we have a better mechanism that I will talk about in a moment. So this one here is not about how you build your application, it's more about what your application is. So you can control the application ID, that's the package name in the manifesto. We call that application ID, by the way, because it doesn't change any package name in your code, right? It's purely the ID of your application on Android. Unfortunately, in the manifest, it says package, which is not super awesome, even though it looks like a Java package, but that's really the ID of your application that must be unique on a device. And then you can control, you know, so, you know, min SDK version, target SDK version, of course, if you want to do an ICS version or Gingerbread version. You can control signing, again, you know, maybe you have two versions that you need to sign differently for business reasons or whatever, and things like that. And then a variant, so what you actually build is a variant, and a variant is a combination of build types and a product flavor. You can have no flavor, in which case, basically, the build type is your flavor, right? You just get a debug and a release version. And you can have multiple dimensions of flavor. So earlier here, you know, if you wanted to do a game that was, you know, paid versus free, but also x86 versus ARM, you could technically create two dimensions of it, although you don't want to actually create that second dimension. I'll get back to that. What's important to know is that it's really like a combination of all of those dimensions. So if you take an example here, the first dimension is really your build type, you have debug release. The second dimension is paid versus free here, and then the third one is Gingerbread and ICS. And so you're going to create every single combination of that, which I will not list, but you can see them. We get developers who are like, well, I just want a paid debug, I don't care about ICS. You know, I do want a paid Gingerbread and a paid ICS version, but I also want just a paid version. It's not possible, right? It's like it's just, you have dimensions, you can make every combination, and every dimension should contribute a flavor. What you can do, though, is create, skip, really, flavor. So for example, you'd want to be mean to your ICS users and say, no free version for you. That's fine. So you just tell Gradle, hey, you know, basically, so you have this variant filter object here, and you pass it a closure, basically, and we're going to use that closure every time we create those combinations, and we'll test whether that closure return true or false. Although it doesn't return true, you receive a variant object, and so you would have two flavors in that variant object, right? So there's a flavor collection. You get the two of them, and then you just test, and you set the Boolean ignore if you should ignore it or not. That way, it's a little bit, we can extend it and add new things. So for now, right now, what you get in the variant filter is just basically that, right? You get the list of, you get the build type, you get the flavors, and you get the default config, but really you don't really need it. It's a global object. You could just access it using, you know, project.android.defaultconfig. And then you have set ignore that allows you to set whether you should ignore it or not. And that's really, that allows you to tweak still the list of flavors when you have some combination that don't make sense. Now, in theory, you know, if you don't care about it, you know, you could keep those combinations, but you know, we're going to create more objects, you know, because we're going to create a lot of tasks for them, and you know, and it's useless. So you should just keep the version.
It keeps the UI clean.
And then in studio, you'll have, yeah, you know, the ability to switch between those variants. And so if you're generating like 15 variants or however many, you know, you should just not show them. In fact, you know, that's, you know, something that, do you want to talk about the number of tasks?
Yeah, oh, we're already there. Okay, I'm following the slides here on my phone, so completely ensuing. So, I'm still doing the old school for ARM and x86, yeah, yeah. So, but I will change that soon. So, if you look at this innocent looking build screen on the left side, right, it's, if you think about how many tasks will result from that? It's more than 300 tasks. So if you would translate that to an AND build, you would have an AND build with 1,000 lines of XML. If you would translate those few lines of code into a Maven build, you would have 18 subprojects, right? For every variant, testing another subproject. So first of all, the expressiveness is really, really cool. It just shows it's not just flexibility, it's also structure, right? That is the sign of any good design. It's a subtle design where you need flexibility, you have flexibility, but a lot of complexity is also hidden that you're not interested in, right? That's one thing. And but it's not just about expressiveness. Again, if you would translate that into an ant build, it's not just that you have this 1,000 lines of XML. You couldn't ask, hey, ant build, what are the flavors? Ant would say, what are flavors? I don't know. I only know targets. Or hey, Maven, what are the flavors? I only know subprojects. There's no way for an IDE to interact in this rich way, like Android Studio. Okay, here are the flavors of that build. You can execute them. You can switch between them. There's no way, like the variant API, you could do really efficient stuff to extend
it. And actually, yeah, that's how the, like, you know, some of the plugins that we talked about, like the performance tracking, you know, from those different companies that are on the exhibition floor, what they're going to do is they're going to look through those variants that we create, and they're going for each variant to query and say, hey, give me the DEX task. And basically, they're going to capture the input of the DEX, and then, which is jar file, right? And then manipulate them, you know, do bytecode manipulation to insert the instrumentation, and then send the result to DEX. So it's very easy for them to just, you know, whenever you create a new variant, their code still works, right? And there's a lot of API there. And I think it's, you know, since we're also doing Studio that works with Gradle, you know, like the work there is already done anyway. I think it's more like at the plugin ecosystem where we can really enable a lot of very interesting, you know, work to be done just because we have this rich model that is queryingable and you can really, and also you can manipulate it. We'll see a little bit later how to do some of that.
And by the way, what the Android plugin is doing, you can do yourself. If you have requirements in your organization for your automation and you want to create your own build language for that, that is a first-class concept in Gradle world. You can do that to make it your very easy for your developers to express their requirements, right? And that's a little bit, can you read that? That's, I don't know, something's broken with that slide. So my point is, with this slide, is that the collaboration between the Google Android team and Gradle has been also on a very deep and conceptual level, and has been, very productive. So we learned a lot from the way Xavier and his team modeled the Android domain. We said, wow, these are really cool concepts we can use for other domains. So if you now look at the Gradle C++ plugins, and I know when you were looking the first time, oh, build types, I know the concept from somewhere, yeah. Right? So this has really inspired us and influenced the way we now modeling other domains with the same concept. So that's pretty cool. And the next iteration of Gradle will have a common abstraction layer for concepts like build variants that have been originally introduced by Android.
Okay. All right, so let's talk a little bit about source sets. So I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with that. So in Android, we have, you know, like a lot of languages, so we have a lot of source folder for all of them. So here, you know, the default one is source main, right? And then you're going to have a bunch of folders and one file in it. There's a few that are missing there. So the important part is that whenever you create a build type or flavor, we have a version for that. So you're going to have, you know, source main, that's the default one, debug, release, paid, free, so one for each of those component. I really don't have a generic name that represents build type and product flavor, but you know, the build types are here, the flavors are here. When we actually build, you know, any variant, we basically take that. So for paid ICS debug, we'll have both the main source set, and then we'll have debug, paid, and ICS. And for the other one, we have the one that matches, right? And so we have some, we introduced that actually not too long ago, but like a few months ago. We have some additional source sets now that we create. So one of them is the full variant source set, so paid ICS debug. And you have one for each of your variants. And then we have another one that I call sort of like multi-flavor, which is basically the full variant minus the build type. And that really only makes sense when you have more than two flavors, because when you have a single flavor dimension, well, that's already paid or ICS, and when you don't have any, well, there's nothing. And also, of course, if you don't have any flavor, well, the variant is basically debug, so it's the same one as this one. So, of course, it doesn't exist either. So we have those additional source set, and so we have some new priorities for them, right? Because there's some combination on the source set, so in terms of priority, right, number one is higher priority. Of course, you have the variant-specific one, because that's the most specific one. Then you have build type, then the multi-flavor, then the flavors, and then the default. And they are combined in kind of like two different type of strategy. Right? On the right, basically, it's just a union. So if you have some source code in Java, in source main Java and in source debug Java, it's just two source folder, but when we send that to the compile task, it's just one set of source, right? And that provides a lot of flexibility that I will talk about in a moment. And then on those one here, so that's the Android resource folder and then the asset folder, we do merging. So that allows you to do overlays. So for example, if you want to override some resources in your debug version or in your variant specific version, just put a resource in there and then it will overlay whatever is in source main race. And of course the manifest, we introduced a few releases ago, probably just around I/O, a new manifest merger that we've improved a lot since then. That does a lot of merging of all those manifests, and you have a lot of fine-grained control over, excluding things coming from a library, figuring out merging strategy in case you have conflicts and things like that. A big question that comes is, well, when should I use variant versus when should I use just dependency project, right? And it's a good question. I don't have this is where when you should use one or when you should use the other one. There's just a lot of pros and cons. So variant allows source set flexibility, which I will talk about in a moment. It allows flexibility also with the ability to have two different dimensions of flavor. So you have to think about, if you wanted to have paid versus free and gingerbread versus ICS as sub-project, then you have, you have some project for ICS-specific code and for gingerbread-specific code, and then maybe those are also, you have a free and a paid version of it, and you get that explosion of project that Hans was talking about, and that's just difficult to do. But if you have a regular, a very simple use case, a library project can give you advantages of just being basically, for example, you have different applications that you ship on different schedule, and they all depend on a particular artifact, a library, and you want to just publish that artifact, and it has its own release schedule, and so that gives you flexibility if you have if you're a big company that releases different applications that just share different type of code. We'll take question at the end. Okay. So if you look in terms of source set flexibility that I was mentioning, if you have if you use library project, so you have your library here and you have two projects using it. The code from project A and project B can, of course, access the code of your library, but the code of your library cannot access project A. So you need to make sure that it's all architectured properly, which when you start from a simple app saying, hey, I want to make a game, and you make your game, and then later on you're maybe I should make a free version of it. Maybe you don't want to architecture everything to make that happen. And so the source set here, same color, so same project, and same really class paths really when you build. Well, in fact, when you build, you either use source main and source paid, or you use source main and source free, right? You never use those two because they're in the same dimension, so they are always exclusive from one another. But the thing that's interesting is that the code in source main can access the source code in source paid or in source free. Because it's, as I said earlier, it's just two source folder, but they're passed to the same compilation task. So it means, though, that when you compile, let's say source main has some class that accepts food, the class foo, you need to make sure that the class foo in each version is always in sync, right? Its API, at least the API that is used from your main source code, is always the same. So there's a little bit of, suddenly I need to manage two versions of the same class, which unfortunately we don't really handle very well, or at all, I should say, in studio, but our goal is to have the ability that, hey, when you do refactoring, we should know that there's two versions of the same class and we should just handle that after one. But we'll get there. We'll get there. That's one way of going. And then we have yet another way of going is that, maybe you just want a single source base and have just a couple of flags here and there. It's like, hey, if I'm running variant foo, maybe I should do that. And if I'm using that other variant, maybe I should do that instead, right? So that's what I would call feature flag. So feature flag is, it's great because you don't have to maintain that same class in both places. But if you start having 200 flags, maybe you should refactor your code a little bit. So it's really up to you to figure out what you want to do. Now, so for feature flag, we have a great way to do that. So you can technically create your own flag, right? You could create a constant class and put it in source debug constant.java and then source paid constant.java, and maintain that yourself. But we have this build config class that really you should be using. I'm always surprised that a lot of developers just don't seem to know about it. So it's generated automatically for you. There's a version for each variant, And it contains a lot of default information already that's very interesting. So you have whether it's debuggable or not. So if you're doing logging, logging, you know, and you don't want any login in your release code, just do if debug. And then when that becomes false, compiler will just remove that. You have your application ID, so that's the package. You have your build type. You have your version code and version name. And then you have the flavor. So here we have the full flavor, which is, you know, gingerbread free. And then you have actually the two flavor with their dimension, right? Flavor API and flavor version there. But of course, it's more interesting if you can actually create your own. So in the DSL, you can very easily just create your own. So before, you could already do that, you know, build config field, string. So here, for example, if you want to access a different server between debug and release, you create debug, build config fig, string, server, whatever your server is. Then you do the same thing in release. I ran out of room, so I couldn't put the release one. And then you would put the same server constant with a different value. And then in your code, you just access, you know, build config.server, and it's always the right one. And so what we just added actually Monday, on the version that released on Monday, is the ability to do that per variant as well. So here, on the variant object, you can now do build config field, and then you create a, you know, so here we create a Boolean called feature one, and we say, you know, it's true only if the name of the release is paid free release. So that's a feature that you only enable on paid free release. And we have raise value, which is sort of similar. Instead of creating those config flags, it creates actual resources, Android resources. You know, we used to have that also on debug, and we also have that now on application variant. And because those are, you know, high, you know, they're variant level, so they're high priority, and so they will override also anything else that you have. I talked earlier about using flavors to do packaging, you know, ARM versus x86, and it used to be an interesting way of doing it, and it's deprecated in favor of Spix. So the idea, you know, do you remember that big, you know, flow that I showed you earlier? That was one variant, right? So imagine doing, you know, ARM versus x86, and then MIPS, and then ARM 64-bit, and then x86 64-bit. Like, you have a lot of dimension, you have a lot of ABI suddenly, and imagine that big flow repeated as many times as you have ABIs, because flavors are so flexible, right? You can provide custom manifests, you can provide custom Java code, you can provide a lot of things. We have to build them completely separately. But when you just want to do packaging, you know, that's not what you want to do. Now, if you said that it's hard for the model to understand that your flavors are very different only in packaging versus, you know, code, because you could somewhere in, you know, insert steps that suddenly adds extra bit of code, and so it would be hard to detect that. And so really, we couldn't really just, you know, optimize the build. So now with splits, basically what we do is that we know that this is going to be just a different packaging. All the Java compilation, proguarding, dexing, you know, resource compilation, all of those tasks that, you know, take a lot of time will be shared across every, you know, splits, basically. So it's just a different packaging for the variant. And we support density and ABI. There's some things that you need to do around the version code, but if you're already using multi-APK, you know that every APK has to have a different version code. So we look at the variant API that allow you to do that. We don't have yet, right now, the ability to filter out a split. So for example, you know, Froyo didn't have Intel, you know, support. So you should be able to say, hey, for my Froyo version, I don't want Intel. We will add that soon. So this is the ABI, again, that allows you to do that. So you just create a split item here. You say density. So by default, we support every density. We will split for every density. So here you start excluding. We have another API that says, OK, first I reset the list, and then I just include what I want to use. And then we realize that, well, what you really want to do when you start splitting by density is having a custom manifest for the compatible screen item, right? Because compatible screen item in the manifest will say the current density and then which screen size you want to do. So here you provide us with the list of screens that you actually support, and then we actually inject that into your manifest for you so that you don't have to maintain, again, a custom manifest just for all of those. And then this one always create a universal APK with all the densities, but you don't have to use it if you don't want to. And then ABI, same thing, you know, you can exclude or include, and then you can decide whether you want a fat binary or not. And then Studio will deal with that also. You know, actually, in Studio, you won't see those because it's purely a packaging. But we actually don't do that yet, but we want to make sure that when you connect your phone and you say, hey, I want to deploy to that phone, we'll only build the split that you ask, that you can deploy, right? So we'll query which, we do that in installation right now, but when you start building from studio, we don't yet do that, but we'll do that in the future. Okay, so multilex, another feature that was added maybe 2 weeks ago, something like that. All right, so who's aware of the multilex issue? Too many of you. okay, so DEX, for those who don't know, the DEX format is limited to 65K method per DEX file. As you can imagine, you know, in 16 index. So after starting with Lollipop, we have native support for it. So basically, you can really split all your code into multiple DEX format. And Android is smart enough now to say, hey, look, there's multiple DEX file inside the APK. Let me extract all of them, convert them using the ahead of time compilation. And then when the app start, all your code is ready to go. That's not the case for for before that. So, of course, we couldn't release a solution without having backward compatibility. Again, because of that, you know, not every phone is running Lollipop yet. So we have a support library that we shipped. It's part of the Maven repository that we ship in the SDK. So what it does is that it's going to be two things. First, Gradle, our plugin, now support computing exactly what needs to go in those DEX files. Because like after 5.0, you know, Android will just see all of those DEX files and take them out and just use all of them right away without caring where the classes are. But the support library, the way it works is basically it does that. So, you know, there's that line, multi-DEX install, that if you have your own application application class, you need to use that. If you don't have one, the support library come with a small application task that you can just insert in your manifest saying, hey, just go use whatever it is. It's like com support, com Android support, multi-DEX application, something, right? So you can just use that directly. But to be able to do that, the application needs to be able to launch, right, to start. And so to do that, we have a computation in the Gradle file that will say, look at all your code and say, okay, what is the minimum set of classes that I need to slightly launch the application just enough to run that code that's going to go and manually go and find all of those DEX files and extract them from your APK and convert them at least on first launch and then load them on every launch. So we do that for you so that you don't have to do anything. And we have that support library. So that's really all you have to do. Multi-DEX enabled equal true. And hopefully it works. And you can set that, on the build type, you can set that on the flavor, on the default config. You cannot set that at the variant level. But so basically, if you have your paid and your free app, and the paid app doesn't need it, but the free app needs it, I don't know what that would be, but let's imagine. You could set it on only one of the variants. Now, the native support is much better, right? As I said earlier, there's no computation needed. DEX will just receive all your code, just create new classes. And basically, the way it works is it starts writing a DEX file. When it reaches 65K, it just says, hey, it's full. Let's start a new file and let's go. But we have pre-DEXing in Gradle to try to run DEX through all of your dependencies. And that's great because before, what we did with pre-DEXing, if you didn't use multi-DEX, we would pre-DEX all of your dependencies. And then once we DEX the code of the main application, we would merge all of that into a single DEX file. Well, we don't even need to do that anymore. We keep pre-DEXing, and then we just package them all, and that's it, done. So it's much faster, right? If you just change your code of your main project, and we just DEX that one, and then we take the previous DEX file for all your dependencies, and we just package all of that, and done. So that's going to be faster. And of course, you don't need to shrink, right? Like I know a lot of developers who are starting to have to use ProGuard even in their debug build because their app doesn't compile anymore. So that's additional build time. And here, you don't need to, right? It's fine if you have 200K method. I don't know what kind of app would have 200K method, but you could. And so what I've been really recommending developer is, hey, you have flavors that allow you to do Gingerbread versus ICS or Gingerbread versus Lollipop. So you could create a Lollipop-only variant by creating a flavor that says, hey, MinSDK 21+. And then when you use that for develop, of course, you need to deploy that to a Lollipop device, or an emulator. But if you do that, you're going to get much faster build time, especially if you have a big app, right, that needs to run through ProGuard just to be able to be installed. Just do that, create that variant. With variant filter, you can make it not even build like a release version. It's only like your debug version. And then Gradle automatically change the behavior whether your min SDK is 21 or below. So whether it's entering legacy mode or not is automatic for you. You don't have to do anything. And then that allows you really to have a faster build time. Because like the multi-dex legacy mode, especially if you're also doing ProGuard, is really like, you know, even slower than before. We have to compute all those classes. And we are looking at ways to at least better support incremental mode for that legacy mode, but you know, making that work is complicated, so we want to make sure that we get it right. But for now, that's a great workaround to have faster compilation time thanks to the flexibility of our plugin. Okay, let's talk about variant APIs a little bit, because we mentioned about that a little bit earlier. To me, that's like one of the great power of our plugin is, you know, you have this way of declaratively, you know, creating your build types and your product flavor, and yes, you can have some custom logic to go and dynamically create flavors. I'm not sure what the really use case is there, but some developer want it, so it, you know, you can do that anyway. Gradle just, you know, it's just a collection of flavor. You know, you can write code to add flavors if you want to. But the great power is, you know, manipulating it after, as I was saying, like those plugin that do like, you know, that instrument your code for performance tracking. So the tooling API, the variant API is really like, you know, once we create all of those variants, you know, here they're created, go in and do whatever you want to modify them. And you get access to, you know, the properties of the variant, right? Which flavor and which build type it contains. So flavor, when you have multiple dimensions, we actually merge them all together because there's an overlay mechanism as well, right? If you have two flavor, pardon me. If you have two flavors and one says, hey, my application ID is com.foo, and the other one says, hey, my application ID is com.bar, well, one of them is going to win, right? They can't both win. So we merge all of those flavors, so we give you that flavor object so that you can maybe verify that it's okay. And long term, we want you to be able to also modify it, right? Saying, well, for that variant, I want a different application ID would be nice. So we're not quite there yet, but we want to give access to that. We have variant-specific configuration object, like you know the build config field that I mentioned earlier, the raised value, and we get access to you know all the tasks, right? That's what I was mentioning earlier. You know, we can query the variant to get access to all the dex tasks and dex task and go in and you know grab its output, convert them, and then give new input to the dex task. So you have a lot of flexibility. So let's start with a simple example here. So the API, right, application variant.all, it's important to put .all because if you put .h, it's not going to do anything. So there's some timing issue with there where we really need to know everything about all your build type and your variant before we create actually all your build type and your flavor before we create any variants. And the only way to do that is to kind of like after all your code is parsed, we actually do things. And so for those who are not familiar with Groovy, .all is really like every item in that collection now currently present or future. So when you set up that closure here, you know, nothing is in the collection, nothing happens. And then later we create all the variants, and as we add them, basically the closure is actually applied to every item that we add to the collection.
It's so like a listener, basically. You hook in into a container.
But I still see some developer doing project after evaluate. So after evaluate is a callback that you get after your project has been evaluated. And we do all our work in after evaluate. So I see a lot of developer doing project after evaluate, and then they do the each because then they know that it's there. It's kind of like useless. You can just do dot all. So here what we do is, on each variant, we're going to basically change the output of the variant to be variant.name. So the part that we changed not too long ago, maybe about a month ago, is that you used to be able to just say variant.output file, and that was it. But now that we introduce splits, a variant is really more than one APK, right? A variant is like your paid ICS debug version, but you could have four APK for each. You could have, you know, medium density x86, high density x86, medium density ARM, high density ARM, right? If you were doing two dimensional of splits. So you get a collection of output. You can query those outputs to get a lot of ID, a lot of things, but you can do that. One thing, and I will show you that in more detail in a moment. One thing that I want to mention here, because I see a lot of developers getting that problem, is that they're like, they have a great idea where they're going to, they want to keep every single build that they have. So they're going to put a timestamp in the build name, in the file name. It's a great idea, except that the way Studio works is that when you import or when you open your project, Studio, through the tooling API, say, hey, Gradle, what's the model? And part of the model is that file name. So we get the model, and then every time we build, we just, you know, we already recorded that file name. We're working with Gradleware to have a better way of getting a new version of the model on every build, but right now we can't. So basically, every time we build, we still use that recorded name, and we deploy that one, even though maybe it built with a different name because the timestamp is in the file name. So don't make this, you know, different based on build. You could do something where, you know, you could make a copy of it if you really want to keep all of them. You can, there's actually some property that tell you whether you're being called from Studio or not. So you could make that dynamic. Say, hey, if I'm being called from Studio, always return the same name, because basically that property will be true whether you build or whether you query the model. But if I'm being called not by Studio, which maybe is CI server, then I want to have a different name, right? You have flexibility to do whatever you want. Let's talk about those outputs here. So this is an example that I was saying earlier, like the multi-APK stuff in Play Store requires that every version code is different. And so you basically have to create a new version code for all of those APKs. And so we had to implement that. It's not just like a different packaging, but we had to actually create a different manifest with just a different version code. There's a little bit of trick to do there. And so here what we do basically is we loop on all the output. So first I create a random map saying, hey, you know, my version code for MDPI is 1, GPI is 2, you know, whatever. And then here I query my output saying, hey, what's the density filter on it? And then I use that as a key on my map. And then I make a composite version code of, you know, it's basically, you know, the higher, you know, higher priority bit is basically the density, and then the rest is your actual version code. And it's up to you to figure out your actual scheme, you know, how many digits you put for the actual version code that you have. And if you have a lot of densities, like if you have split plus a density for, you know, gingerbread versus lollipop, for example, you're going to have that composite version code is going to have a lot of different, you know, sections, right? There's going to be your version code, and then, you know, you're going to have, you know, probably split. And then the API level should always be the higher version. So that should be the first one, the higher order one. So you have to compose that yourself. There's really no other way for you to do that because we can't really figure out the scheme for you. And you know, any other build system that doesn't give you the ability to write a little bit of code for that would just not work well with multi-APK. And then you just basically say, hey, you know, I want to create the output with that particular version code. You can also change the version name. So here I just put the version code in there. Because some developers have asked us to be able to, you know, when you look at the about box or whatever, you can see what the version name is, or when you look about the app stuff, actually. Okay, and then finally, adding steps is, so it's very easy too, right? So we looked at a rich model of what a variant is and some of its properties, but really down below to like a much lower level, there's just task in the end. And so here what we do is, ultimately, we do that, right? We create, let's create a task first. So task.create, that's the standard, like if you ever created, you know, tasks manually in Gradle, that's the way you do it. You pass it a name and you pass it a type, so type jar here. So that particular example is very simple. It's like, hey, the output of the Java compilation is a folder full of class file. Let's make a jar out of that and send that to Dex, which is really not needed, but that's an example. So here, the name and all those tasks have to be unique, right? You can't create two, you know, jar my code task, right? It has to, so we have a pattern in our plugin where it's always like, you know, jar and then the variant name or process variant name manifest, right? So process debug manifest, process release manifest. So the variant provide a name and we guarantee that name is unique. So do use it in your task. So we create that task, and then after what we need to do is make that task depend on the Java compile task so that it runs after. We make the dev task run, you know, depend on this task, and then we change the output. Actually, there's, you know, well, here you would wire the output from the Java compile task, and then we see here, you know, the input file of the desk task is, you know, the output of my task. We do want to provide better API to do that because it's kind of like, you know, well, first you need to know that it's like, hey, it's input files, and we need to make sure that we don't change that under you so that your plugin breaks. And typically, bytecode manipulation is something that apparently a lot of plugins are doing. And so we want to provide some API to help you get do that kind of thing. But you have, if you're like really brave and you're okay with potentially having your custom logic break whenever you update plugin, you can access everything from those tasks here, right? So you can go look at the source code, it's open source, and just go at it and and change whatever you want. It's up to you. We'll try, at least in the source code, to have some comment about, hey, this is a private API and this is a public API. It's hard to actually enforce that, but we put some comment in the source code that show what's really public and what's not public. And we're working on a DSL reference doc for 1.0 that will show all the properties that we already support, although that won't include those yet, but we'll include them shortly after. But technically, you can go and use whatever you want. If you're ready to maintain it whenever we change things, it's totally possible. I'm going to run very quickly through dependency management because that's really a big feature of Gradle and one of the reasons also that we chose Gradle, right? So dependency management is very important, and we have three scopes. We have compile time, right? That's provided, package only, and compile. So the provided is only sent to the Java compilation, but not packaged. Package is only packaged, but not sent to the compile class path. So that allows you to provide different version of compile versus runtime if you wanted to, and compile is both. We have those three scopes on, again, the main part that's shared for everyone, and then all the debug, all the flavor, all of that contains also those three. So you have a whole bunch of configuration that you can really do dependency the way you want. What's new in 0.14.3, which is obsolete, there's a 0.14.4 already, is variant-specific configuration. So a lot of developers have asked for that. If you want to have a compilation dependency that's very specific to paid ICS debug, you can do that. And also, we provide the multi-flavor one. So there's one small limitation is due to some timing that we are working on to fix is when you want to use a multi-flavor or variant dependency, you have to create it first. Because by the time, I mentioned after evaluate earlier, by the time we actually create the variant, that code would have been executed already, and that would not have been created yet. So you really need to, you create it first, you define all your flavor, all your stuff in here, and then you use it. And then when we create the variant and we say, hey, you created that variant, we need a configuration object for it, we'll be like, there's already one, let's use it. And it will work. So it's kind of a crappy limitation. As I said, we're working on a lot of improvement in Gradle to make that work better, but right now that's a limitation. So, so before I mention that, well, actually I will mention that on that slide. So, all those dependency scope that you have, like debug main or compile and then debug compile, all of that, when you build paid ICS debug, we take all of the configuration and we tell Gradle that this is one configuration made up of all of those, just resolve all of that. So if you have, let's say, Guava 15 in compile and Guava 17 in debug compile, the 17 will win. You won't get both, right? It will just do the right thing. Now, we have the ability to embed WareAPK. We added that a few months ago, around I/O, I think. But now we used to only have WareApp, so you couldn't embed a different version depending on your flavor. So now we can in 0.14.3. You have ICS WareApp now, for example. So here, we have to do something different, though. We can't just take everything and say, hey, suddenly if you're building ICS, you're going to get the default version plus the other one, because then we would package two versions. And we can't package two versions of your micro app. We can only package one. So here, the behavior is slightly different, is that we just take the highest priority one. So if you put a paid ICS debug web app with another one, we would use this one only for paid ICS web app. So the behavior is slightly different, but you have the same flexibility as you have in the regular compiled and provided and package scope. Dependency management.
To give you some perspective, Gradle is used not just in the Android world, it's used for building some of the biggest software stacks in the world, right? And dependency management is a big problem. It's not a solved problem yet, right? So there are many issues we have started to provide solutions for. So for example, a simple problem is you want to tell your dependency management system, hey, whatever is in my transitive graph, please be aware that Google Collections has been replaced by Guava, right? So another thing is you have aggregations, well, there has been a certain module, and then it has been split into multiple pieces in later versions. So And with standard Maven dependency management, there's no way you can tell this to the dependency resolution engine. So this is all stuff you can do with Gradle. And one thing that we're seeing is that I'm not sure what the situation is for you. So the traditional setup for Android teams was that they were a pretty isolated group in the organization when it came to their delivery pipeline, right? And also how the organization was structured. What we're now seeing in many organizations, LinkedIn is for example one example, they're now completely reorganizing their teams. There's no longer the Android team and the iOS team and the JavaScript team. The teams are now organized around the features, right? They're working on, right? And then everyone. So that means iOS and Android developers and JavaScript developers, it's all one team. And that puts a lot of pressure on having a much more coherent delivery pipeline. And then you get into a more complex situation, and then this stuff becomes interesting, right? Once you're not just building one app, but once you have a lot of dependencies that is constantly changing in your organization and the large dependency graph there, powerful dependency management is super important, right? That you don't have a fragile class path that where you just be lucky that the order in the class path is right, that things are not collapsing, right? Another thing that you can do is rich selection. So you can say, hey, Gradle on dev, give me the latest, let's say, latest foo, right? Whatever is there. And then you can say on QA, well, Gradle, give me the latest foo, but one that hasn't has the name better in its version stream. So you can do some really smart binary integration. Give me the latest that obeys some constraint. So for modeling a rich continuous delivery pipeline, those are very powerful features. For Android, what will be very interesting and that will come very soon is a variant-aware dependency management. What does it mean? Who of you is using Android is creating Android libraries, right? So and Android libraries can have a build type, right? So they can be, and at the moment, when you publish an Android library, you only can publish the release version, correct? Right? Yep. Because the dependency management doesn't understand the concept of variant, right? And what we are working on is a dependency management that understands that you want a certain library, let's call it foo, right? But and when you say, hey Gradle, I now built my Android app in debug mode, then it automatically gets foo in the debug variant, and if foo has another library dependency, moo, right, it gets also the debug variant. And the debug variant can have a completely different transitive graph than the release variant. So that is something we're working on, and I think will be a cool feature, first for Android and then also for many other languages. I think every domain has that problem, right? Okay, so right. Before we start the Q&A.
Yeah, let's go relatively quickly
yes.
Through the roadmap. So, performance. Who's happy with performance in Gradle?
What?
Wow. you didn't notice that I did not raise my hand either. Well, okay, you just raised your hand, but you're using Maven, right?
No, I'm using Maven for...
Yeah, he was the one guy raising his hand about Maven.
But we use locally for local our development, we use Gradle.
Oh, okay.
The production app is built by Maven.
Okay. So we are well aware that there's an issue with performance. A lot of it is really on our side, like on the Android side, where you know Dex is not really incremental. You know, ProGuard is not incremental. Compilation of resources is not incremental. You know, and we have some project internally that takes several minutes to merge to process the resources. The merging is incremental of the resources. You know, merging manifest is not, but it's not really a problem. So we know that there's a lot of issues where we can solve things, and we are going to actively work on that. On the Gradle side.
Yes. Yeah, so, I mean, the thing is, if you compare us to the classical build systems in that area, Gradle is a fast build system. But the point is, we got very ambitious what we want to do,
yes.
Right? So, and that is kind of pushing what is perceived as fast. So, so first of all, I think we are continuously working on many little pieces to make the performance improvement better. So I think with O14, which is using Gradle 2.1, there has been a significant boost for the performance for many Android projects, kind of 20-30% for many projects because we did a much more efficient class loading for external plugins, right? And The next version of Gradle has now functionality that keeps the whole class loader warm in a daemon. So we should, once Android is consuming that, we should see another nice improvement. So there are many areas where you can improve the performance, many little stuff that adds up. But then we do also some deep, very deep work at the moment to push Gradle basically to a new performance level. And a key for that is that we're working on a much richer configuration model. So first of all, this has a benefit in itself. Who of you has ever used after evaluate in modifying? Yeah, and it kind of sucks, right? It's kind of, in terms of, I mean, it's great, again, compared to AND and other build system, wonderful, right? But because this ecosystem is now getting so rich, Gradle extended by Android, Android extended by other plugins, after evaluate gets a little bit crowded. And that's why we also have situations like with the configuration that you can't do it the way you want to do it.
Or we have like some people telling their developer, hey, you need to apply your plugin after you do this because, well, after evaluate is just a straight up list, right? And so you can't really manage that. It's like, you know, having to manually maintain the proper list of plugins just doesn't make a lot of sense.
So that is an ordering issue. We just need to provide a richer model. We will provide a CRAS model for configuration actions, and that will be a very elegant solution to that. Whether you use it directly or you now enjoy a plugin system that is much better integrated, doesn't matter, it will benefit all of you. But the other thing a richer configuration model allows us is to reliably store the Gradle model. At the moment, we always have to recreate it because we don't know exactly what is going on in your build script, right? You could have system current time millis everywhere, and we have no idea, do we need to recreate the model or not? With the new configuration model, we have much more knowledge, and we know, hey, nothing has changed in that build, we are sure, so we can persist it, we can reuse it, and that will be a key thing, getting the configuration time to zero, basically, especially with the Android Gradle interaction.
Yeah, that's super important. Like every time you change your build.gradle file in Studio and you click sync, right, it has to reevaluate all of those projects. And we have some projects inside Google that have like, you know, a couple hundred, you know, projects, and it takes a couple of minutes to evaluate. So every time you click sync, it takes like 3 minutes or something like that.
Yes, the thing is, incremental build is only for execution. Even if you don't change the build script, the build always is re-evaluated, and that's going to change. It will also allow a much more efficient configuration because we need to configure less. And last but not least, we will have parallel task execution, because we are now reaching a point where we're saying, hey, it's so cool that you don't have to have all those sub projects, but the only way you can have parallel execution in Gradle is actually having stuff
separate
across
project.
Sub-project. That's not a very good story. So there will be parallel task execution also soon to come. So this will be a real jump when it comes to Gradle responsiveness and Gradle performance behavior. There's other stuff we're doing. You know, there's the Gradle daemon. The Gradle daemon will become much more powerful. We will work on a preemptive mode that the Gradle daemon constantly check in a watch mode what is changing. If the build script has changed, right, it will immediately renew the model, things like that. This is not 2016, right? We are working already with organizations on that to make that a reality. There's other stuff we can do to improve the build output cache. So one thing, while you've introduced the splits, we will anyhow increase some basic efficiency to have a better reuse of build output across tasks and across builds. So, and to give you an understanding, this is pushed from two sides. So there's the Android Studio side that even with small projects, when you have a rich interaction with the build system, every second counts. And on the other side, you mentioned the large internal Google project. LinkedIn is having a 4,000 submodule Gradle build, right? So we get pushed from the very large scale code bases as well as from also smaller projects that have a rich integration with the IDE, and they all need the same thing, and we're getting there. So you should be able to see the first experimental results of that in the next months. Right. So that's.
So it's definitely a big focus for us. Do you want to talk about
that? Let's skip that. I mean, there's a lot of other stuff we're working on, so it's not just Android, right?
Yeah.
So, and the reality is our heterogeneous software stack, so.
Okay, so on the Android side, we have some work on incremental dexing. It's going to take a while for us to switch, but we hope to show something relatively quickly. Same thing for incremental resource compilation, right? I was just mentioning that running APT is just one step, and so we're going to work on that. And we definitely want to improve the deployment during development cycle where, you know, it would be nice not to have to redeploy the whole APK every time. Testing is also a big area, you know, after performance that we want to do. We do realize that there's a lot of issue in testing, you know, unit testing and you know, better reporting and running those tests from the ID is definitely an area that we want to focus on in 2015. And then finally, NDK integration. So, you know, Hans showed like that example of, you know, that new native plugin that they have. And it's a great plugin for us to build on top of. So we already have, you know, a plugin that uses that internally. We haven't really released it because, you know, it's not quite final on the Gradle stuff. So the API changes regularly. So, you know, it's hard for us to release something and say, hey, you know, start using it if things are going to change. But it's definitely something that we're working actively on. So those are, you know, performance testing and ADK integration is like the three, to me, like the three big things that we want to work in 2015. All right, let's do questions. We have about 10 minutes for questions. You raised your hand early on. So the question was about Flavor for like library project. You technically,
I mean, strictly speaking, it's a build type, right?
Yeah. I mean, you can have build type for library project, but you have to manually go in and tell it that you want to publish both, and you have to in your app go in and manually depend on them, which doesn't really scale when you start having multiple flavors. And so the new thing that Hans was talking about the variant-aware dependency management will help with that, but there's some ways to kind of sort of do it. We can see that after in more detail if you want help.
So would it? It depends, I guess, to some degree whether this library is part of one build, whether it's part of a multi-module build. Then it would be easy, I guess, to reuse it.
A little bit, yeah.
Yes, or whether you do it via a repository.
Well, if you deploy it to a repository, that's a bit then more it's complicated. Any Right. So there's a lot. So right now, because we're in pre-1.0, we sort of like, you know, we have very specific compatibility level between Studio Gradle and the Gradle plugin that will go away after 1.0, where I think our target is to have our plugin support 2.0 and above for Gradle, for plugin to support 2.0 and above, and then have Studio work with our plugin 1.0 and above. And have our plugin works with Studio 1.0 and above, whatever the value is. So all that pain that you have right now is because like we are using some internal APIs, and you know we are still figuring things out. Like the model that we exchanged between Studio and Gradle, you know, we had to finalize it and to tweak it. And you know, like when we introduced the split, it was like, well, we need to add that in the model, and so that now we are like we're good. And you know, we also commit that when we will have to change things in the future, we'll go through like long deprecation period of you know. Adding stuff to the model, but still supporting the old one, so that if you old, if you're in, I don't know, it's like Studio 2.0, you load a plugin, a project using plugin 1.0, it should work, right? And we'll just make it work until 5.0 or whatever, where we'll say, okay, it's done, right? We stop supporting really old plugins. So we'll have, we know that it's been very painful right now, and we'll.
But I mean, the reason is pretty simple. So. So Gradle is extremely backwards compatible, right? But because we worked so closely together, it was always about the latest version of Android Studio was requiring the latest version of Gradle for some of the features that were required for some of the functionality. So and that is why we're always saying you need to upgrade to Gradle, not because of that. But that was the pre-1.0 deal basically, right? We don't guarantee backwards compatibility, but Gradle itself, a Gradle build script. During a major stream is always backwards compatible, and now the Android plugin will enter the same game,
which is going to be painful.
The Android plugin
uses private APIs. So we used to, but we stopped not too long ago. But we don't use that anymore. But also, as Hans was doing, we like every new version, like we were using some new features of Gradle, and instead of like. Saying, well, if you use the old version, then we won't use it. It's like, hey, we're pre-1.0. Let's just you know force everyone to move on that.
And private API is not necessarily a problem because we work well together. So even if there's some private API usage, it doesn't mean we can work that out that this co-evolves properly. So that is something. It is a little bit more work for both of us to do, but we will make sure that this works and there's a continuous integration process between the Android plugin and Gradle. So yeah.
Yeah, but that doesn't really help the developer figuring out what that is.
So it's not Gradle, right? It's either our plugin or Dex.
Well, it is Gradle because it builds, and then when I hit run, debug, it tries to pre-compile again. It calls in the Dex compiler and gets confused.
Right, but it's not. What I mean is that it's not Gradle itself. It's somewhere, you know. Yeah, it's Dex that sends that. Yeah, we'll have to look. Dex is not super awesome about really, you know, giving error code, and we need to improve that.
In general, one other thing we get out of the new configuration model is that you get more insights when things go wrong. At the moment, sometimes, but anyhow, this is not related to that. It's just a general thing. So we appreciate anyhow. I think both of us that we want to give good feedback if things are not working out. So there is room for improvements on the Android plugin side, but also on the Gradle side. So, but yeah, we have to.
No, people hit that with, well.
It also happens with Maven.
Yeah, well, for probably different reason, because that one seemed to be multi-dex one, but like the unexpected top-level exception happen in DX whenever you do something that it's not happy about. So I've seen that happen in ADT, and yeah, we need to go in and ask the DX team to fix it.
Please.
My question is about auto-completion on Gradle 5.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Auto completion on Gradle file. So we have a little bit of it. It's not awesome. It's definitely something we want to do, but it's something where, you know, we want to have some sort of API so that a plugin can contribute through that tooling API to an IDE or whatever, saying, hey, here's my DSL spec or whatever, so that. Because right now we have to hard code that into Studio, where I say, hey, you know, if you're inside an Android one, you have access to build types or product flavors, and it's very manual. It's something that we need to cooperate on to make sure that we can make something automatic.
I have another question to Jay.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. So that is the thing is, I mean, one step at a time. Yes. So and the thing is, we think build users are a little bit more important than build authors. So therefore, in our priorities, you know, because it's a much, much bigger audience where we first want to get the experience right. We're fully on the same page. You want to have that. And there might be some nice incremental steps that already will improve the experience a lot without having the ultimate smartness. So that's something. So, but we agree that this is something that is not irrelevant or not minor.
Well, I think it's also coming from, I mean, you know, like with the example that Hans was giving, like, you know, working with like LinkedIn that has like, you know, really enterprise type of build, it's going to be a type of setup where you have, you know, like build masters that just work through that and no Gradle, like learn it and no Gradle, and you know, the developers never touch those files and don't care. And you know, we're clearly pushing Gradle into more like, you know, like a single developer that's both coding for Android and managing their build file. And you know, and it's things that we have to solve, clearly. Yeah. We're just not there yet, where you know, we need to improve the tooling for the random developer who's going to touch their Gradle file every month, or every like 3 months, or every 6 months, and really don't remember exactly, oh, what's the syntax, right? It's a different use case, and we're really like stretching a little bit like the current boundaries of Gradle, and we need to, you know.
Which is good for us. I mean, it's really, so accepted, and it has to be extendable, right? It can't be just work for the core plugins, and so we have some ideas around that.
Actually,
yes, yeah. So point taken. We're not actively working on it right now, but it's something that is important to us.
And, you know, I want to mention, I think it's a good segue, I'm hiring. You know, if you're interested in helping those tools, you know, come talk to me. Are you hiring?
There
you go.
We take the Bay Area, we take the rest of the world. So,
I'm curious about the
SDK manager, yes, there is, you know, right now you have to click through that license. So we can't really do anything about it much, but we do want to improve the situation, and that's all I will say. All right. You see that first line here? And it's not quite ready, but that's where we're going. It's not, you know, quite ready, you know, which is why we haven't really talked about it. I think we're working on a blog post about it. And actually, the incremental feature is not really in it and not integrated in Gradle, but that's the beginning of, like, we're, you know, trying to fix the situation and provide some new compiler for that.
I saw there was a flag that you can use.
Use Jack on build type, default config, product flavor. Start using it. It does Java compilation, texting, shrinking and obfuscation, no optimization, but it takes regular progar file. What it doesn't do right now is like annotation processor or Jacoco instrumentation. And it doesn't, it technically supports jar jar so that you can automatically, you know, as you add dependencies, rename them, but it's not integrated in Gradle yet. But yeah, use jack equal true, and then you will. You need like 21.1 build tools. Try it out, send us feedback on the AOSP bug tracker. We'll have more updates, and you know, the team is, you know, busy working on that, so hopefully we'll have regular updates to the compiler and more features coming through.
I think maybe a very last question.
An example of the package scope. It's a good question. I don't really have one. I remember like some developers saying, hey, we absolutely need package scopes. Like, sure, whatever. Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, long term, I would like to see, it's not quite the same, but it's the same idea is, you know, like in the library, I would definitely would want to see AR having both a API jar and a, you know, full jar, right? To be able to restrict saying, you know, I do want to depend on that jar, but I don't, you know, and there's a bunch of classes in it that are, you know, implementation detail that I don't want people to use. So, you know, if you didn't have that in a jar, you know, in an AR file, you could have like two jar, right? It's like it's foo.api and foo.runtime, right? And foo.api is only a small set, and that's the one that's guaranteed to always be there. And so you do a provided on foo.api, foo-api, and then you do a package on foo.runtime. And then the advantage is that when you're inside Studio, you will never hard code completion on stuff that's inside the runtime one, and you will never, by mistake, use something that really you shouldn't. All right. So that's one example. I think for AR, it's actually very useful, you know, because you push something to developers, and you know, it's nice if when you update from 1.0 to 1.0.3, you know, you haven't renamed three class that they use, but really they shouldn't have been using. But hey, they looked at it because inside Studio, it's like, hey, look at that class. It looks awesome. I'm going to use it, even though they weren't meant to use it, right? So providing more control is something that you can do. But that's the typical use case. It's something, actually, an important point is that provided and package do not work if you use ARs, actually, because, you know, it's only for the AR dependencies only work with the compile scope. Because what does it mean to have resources that are only used for packaging but not for, you know, compile time, right? It's like if you have Android resources, you need to generate the R class and you really need to run them through the whole compile step. Same thing for provided, right? If you have an AR and you put it to provided and you create an R class but you don't package the resources, you're going to have problem at runtime. So those two are really very specific for jar file only and not like full AR.
Yeah. Thanks a lot.
All right. Thank you, everyone.